So it was great to see Lincoln's family. well, I was asked to talk a little bit about healthcare delivery systems and some of the infrastructure. And I purposefully am not going to spend a lot of time on two key areas. One is the test itself. There's a lot of different tests that are available, and it is an important tactic in terms of achieving precision medicine. But I would put forward that we're trying to build a superhighway that can accommodate whatever kind of vehicle that is seen both now and in the future. So if we did separate highways for cars versus trucks versus semi trucks versus motorcycles, we would pave the entire country. Instead, we've chosen to build a highway that accommodates all those different vehicles. It's not always safe for all of them. It's not always perfect. But it does accommodate whatever new kind of vehicle comes forward. And I put that forward because too much of precision medicine has come out of genomics for genomics' sake. And as other tools come forward, whether metabolomics, proteomics, radiomics, fill-in-the-blank omics, it's going to need to go on that same exact highway, or we're going to have to pave over our entire medical system. And so put that forward for that piece. The other thing is that, as has been highlighted by others, if we don't have good options for patients based on whatever it is we're measuring in them, why are we doing it at all? And that's really been highlighted by a number of papers, including the paper that Amy Abernathy alluded to yesterday, a JAMA paper that came out showing a slight difference in those who got testing, molecular testing, versus those who didn't. The main difference was seen in those centers that had a lot of clinical trial options. Hardly any difference was seen where there weren't clinical trial options. No surprise. If I want a pizza and there's no pizzas available, I'm not going to be happy. And pizza for breakfast is a thing. Those are two key areas. Instead, I focused a little bit on the delivery piece itself. Now, I too have disclosures, and I'm supposed to leave them for some unit of time. I'm on board of directors of some companies. I'm an advisor to some companies, including governmental companies. I think that the NIH and the FDA also are sources of bias and need to be declared, not just pharma. I am employed by Moffitt Cancer Center. It's a nonprofit, but it certainly has its own biases. And I'm in debt to my wife. And so those are all sources of bias that can influence me in dramatic ways. Also want to highlight the clinical problem is really much less dramatic than we like to think. Often we like to think of ourselves as Michelin 3-star restaurants, where you show up, there's no menu, you're given a list of what you're going to receive, there's 27 items, they're this big, and they're all amazing, and then you get a massive bill at the end. And that's how we practice medicine. You're told what you're going to get, you're given it, and you get a massive bill at the end. In reality, it's much more like Golden Corral. Now, I'm not sponsored by Golden Corral, you might think so, but the idea that we go, and there's a bunch of different entrees, we need to select an entree and go forward. Now, Golden Corral, you can take multiple entrees. But in medicine, we have to pick from amongst a bunch of equal options. You know, when you look at New England Journal tomorrow night when it gets emailed to you, or if you're under 40 when you get the tweet about it, you're going to see a clinical trial of some sort, and there will be a survival difference, and big enough that it got into New England Journal of Medicine. And there will be the winner and the loser of that clinical trial. In reality, it's first-line and second-line therapy. The winner will be first-line therapy, and then if that doesn't work, we'll try the other one, which is the next best thing. And so when you're talking to a patient, you say, I'm sorry, winter therapy didn't work for you. We're going to try loser therapy now. That's not the way we approach it. And I belabor this point because we need to change the way we're thinking about delivering medicine, choosing from amongst equal options or apparently equal options. Because if you have two equal options, a feather will tip that scale. And the type of data that we need is sometimes a feather, not necessarily a massive weight of some sort. Multiple active options, variation in response to treatment, so we need to understand the individual's response. Toxicity is often the driver of who stays on what therapy. And of course, there's the issue that none of us want to talk about, and that is that these things cost money and cost a lot of money. It would be that much money And so we need to pay attention to that as we're going forward. So we need to understand what is the clinical need, which test and why, which drug or not. And by drug, I really mean therapy. It could be radiation. It could be a number of approaches. Be a clinical trial or some sort of off-label use, and I guess on-label should be on there as well. How to get all the above into the EMR in a functional way, how to pay for it, and a bunch of other stuff that couldn't fit on this slide. And so there's a lot to go after as we're trying to achieve this. We also have multiple genomes. The patients have a tumor genome. They have a germline genome. Efficacy and toxicity could be one way of describing those two genomes in terms of trying to go forward. And then, if, like I didn't put it in that particular slide, there's also genomes for bacteria, for virus, other things that are also important for managing our patients. Now, using the genomes, it's also what I'm showing here is the amount of clinical consults being done per month over the last few fiscal years. And the use just keeps going up and up and up. We're using a lot of genomics. We're using it in all sorts of different tumor types and using a number of different assays to achieve those goals. And so I put these points up there just to kind of highlight that this isn't something that may happen someday. This is happening now, and it's happening with a suitable level of complexity to need some important attention. Now, in terms of clinical actionability, we're seeing use in a couple of key things. And again, this is how we're having to design our workflows and think about delivering care, because we're looking for resistance or benefit for therapies. We're looking for FDA-approved therapies. We're looking for clinical trials that would be a reasonable option based on an objective driver of some sort, not just what's open at our center. Off-label use is a thing, and it could be a rational thing if we're careful. Alterations for diagnostics or prognostics, and those of us in the field will have stories from each month of diagnoses that have been dramatically changed for the good or for the better based on the molecular findings compared to even just a normal histopathology. And then, of course, germline alterations involved with toxicities and efficacy that are quite important. And part of it is because there's lots of different choice. Golden Corral, we have lots of different options there to choose from, and we don't want to just use them blindly from there. Also, the complexity is really important. So here is an FDA-approved test that was done on a patient within the last 2 weeks. I won't say the date, so you can't hack our system and identify the patient. It was done by an outside lab. We accommodate both in-house and out-house testing for that. And so this was done outside lab. And as you can see at the top, no reportable alterations based on the FDA claims. But with no reportable alterations becomes a whole host of different variants on page 1, and then a bunch of variants on page 42 and page 43. So if you are a well-trained medical oncologist who happens to do a PhD in molecular oncology and are used to understanding the genomic output from tumor sequencing, you will have a hard time dealing with this type of situation. For the rest of you, you're hosed. There is very difficult to think of ways of actually trying to manage this in a useful fashion. And what's not on this, because the testing company had no way of getting it, is the context. This happens to be a glioblastoma multiforme patient that was on the chart. It was first diagnosed in 2010, so they're a ways out. It's not normal. This is their third resection that was being tested. They've had prior radiation, temozolomide. Okay, I can start understanding why they have so many variants all over the place in their genome. And then, of course, I mentioned the pages that one has to look. Many of our well-trained oncologists don't look beyond page 1. And, of course, we don't have not well-trained oncologists. There's a lot to do to try to make this something that's useful and not just a distraction and a source of expense. Now, computational support for cancer has been done for quite some time. You have a serum creatinine clearance calculated for you from your electronic medical system. You have a number of other factors that are calculated already for you. Fully AI-driven care may happen someday. The reason it hasn't happened to date is a couple reasons. One, there's a lot of complexity. Second, there really hasn't been that hard work done to build the knowledge to have the I in AI. The A is present for AI. The I is what's been missing and has not really been invested in fully for as far as broad cancer care. For now, we just need to be smarter. So having systems that let us make sure we don't overlook patient characteristics. This patient is quite large. This patient has bad kidneys. This patient has heart failure. Are all things that we may not be looking at because we're looking at the tumor. And the PET scan doesn't have those things in it, but are very important. Missing treatment options, trials we didn't know about, off labels we didn't think about, choosing from amongst equals is really, really important. Patient preferences. Maybe one therapy has less of a copay for that patient, and they won't have to sell their car to pay for next week's therapy. Maybe they don't want to travel to that clinical trial site. Maybe the oral therapy is better for them, or IV therapy is better for them because of their, knowing those things, we can build that in. Keeping on pathway in terms of our responsibilities both to quality of care as well as the fiscal responsibilities, and just figuring out what to do with the genomic data. So in our case, we've had to build our own system. We have not found a system available otherwise that accommodates all that we need. And we didn't make it fancy looking, but it does things like gives us the allele frequencies within a tumor and the functional domains. And we can go in and get things whether we've seen it before. So we have about 4,100 patients that have had clinical grade sequencing on one of the modern platforms. And only twice have we seen this particular variant in SMO. And that was once in a brain tumor and once in a non-melanoma skin cancer. Is not in the normal genome of 1,000 genomes. It's also not in exome variant server somewhere here. ClinVar, what it looked is pathogenic in ClinVar. Here's where it's located. The OncoKB results are shown here. We've drawn from a bunch of different external and internal sources. We've had to have both graphical, numerical, and qualitative type data, all brought in to help us try to make a more rapid decision on the 120 patients a week that we're having being clinically sequenced at our particular institution. So it's a lot of different types of complexity that have to be brought in. It's not just a magic button, yes, treat, no, treat. There's a lot of these things that have to be part of it as we're going forward. In order of prevalence, what's most commonly done in terms of an actual process for care, most common is do nothing. Well, it's actually it's hope for the best is really what it is. It is, here's the results of the test. Here is what a company or our internal pathology department has recommended. Pathologists can't pronounce drugs and so should not make drug recommendations by personal bias. Therefore, here you go. Good luck to you. And as Lincoln pointed out, that does not work well because no one has their back. You order a CT scan, radiology has your back. You order a genome scan, you're on your own. So that sort of support is needed. Molecular tumor board is an important element. Active but reactive clinical assistance, so call us if you need us. Active but preemptive, our place, Lincoln as well, every test, whether it's internal or external, gets a consult. So when you look at that CT scan and you see the radiologist's expert opinion next to it, you have that extra confidence. When you look at the pathology report and you see the personalized medicine clinical service report next to it, you have that extra piece. So there are all those different variations that can occur. The factors that influence it really are boiled down to some very simple things. Is there an internal champion or expertise to really deliver this? And most places do not have medical oncologists, pathologists, radiation oncologists, surgeons that have that higher level of competence to bring this forward. There's a real lack at academic centers and elsewhere. The financial and strategic support from the leadership is very important because they have to be able to see that spending a dollar will save them money or will give them market advantage or in some way make it worthwhile going forward. And the ability to engage multidisciplinary teams. I made a joke about pathologists not being able to pronounce drugs, but if you do not have engaged pathologists within your team, you are not going to be delivering any quality of care. You need oncology, pathology, pharmacy, health IT to be actually carrying water, not just showing up for occasional meetings, if you're going to make this thing be real in terms of trying to advance patients' care. So you can come up with clinical flows that come up, that go everywhere from which patient, which tissue, prior authorization type elements, all the way through down to discussions with the patient, patient tools, letters of medical necessity, et cetera, that are there. We've also created, we have a molecular tumor board that meets weekly and goes over every case, both in real time and then at a face-to-face meeting. We also have a monthly meeting that we call the Clinical Genomics Action Committee. And the reason we call it that is the difficult cases, if they go to a molecular tumor board in the academic sense of the word, too often they're academic freak shows. We're looking and say, you know, that patient had a JAK2 amplification. JAK2, isn't that crazy? JAK2, haven't seen that for a while, next. As opposed to what do we do to help this woman with her sarcoma and get better care? And so getting that emphasis on the output, not the fascination, is really important. We fell into that trap. We had to change the name to get ourselves past it. But we can get a lot of different disciplines who normally only meet in the cafeteria and talk about the World Cup to actually talk about cancer in this context. Getting this into the electronic medical record in a way that can stimulate clinical decision support is key. This can't just be something that's on the side and not formal. And lastly, helping with letters of medical necessity. Not every patient is eligible for a clinical trial. Many of our patients, it's a third cancer, they have bad kidneys, but they're still fit and want to go forward. We need to be able to help them. And so need to be able to have the data to understand when to ask for therapy. And we've decreased our requests a lot because of this, but have higher quality requests that go in as we're going forward. So last little piece is just a reminder, there's those other genomes. We have all these genomes to think about, and that's just at the nucleic acid level and need to be part of our way forward. And so we're now layering out approaches that are more of a germline strategy, looking at neuropathy, cardiotoxicity, bone marrow, gastropathy risk, some of the hereditary stuff, as Lincoln has mentioned, and then also things that are important to cancer. Pain control, antiemetics, antifungals. I forgot to put it on there, but antidepressants. Medical oncologists did not go through all that training to be good at prescribing antidepressants. And yet, a third of their patients need an antidepressant prescription. And so helping them make a better choice rather than what's on my pin is really an important part of this going forward. And the reasons we're doing that is not only for bits of quality of care, and I know my red light's on, but if you look at lymphoma, patients with neuropathy, on average, they cost $28,000 extra in the first year of care if you have neuropathy compared to not having neuropathy. And they cost 15 clinic slots in the first year. Think new patient slots that are now clogged up by toxicity that gives no one any benefit because we're not reimbursed well for this sort of thing. And so we now have some additional drivers in addition to clinical care. We can drill down to what those are at a deeper level to really drive things forward. So my last slide here, a couple of highlights. Selection from amongst equals is what we need our systems to be able to help us do. Rational therapeutics, risk mitigation, budget impact analyses will really help us go forward in terms of quality of care, but also influence our payer strategies. Payers are interested in data. They want to make good decisions, and they can be really good partners on this. Quality improvement also has to fit in. You know, what works well at Intermountain may not work at Moffitt and vice versa. We need to know what is going to be useful. As Mia mentioned, either this has to occur in the EMR or on the EMR. And so how does that happen and go forward? And then lastly, we often ignore toxicity. And toxicity is the major thing patients complain about. It is the reason they stop active therapy. And often, it's toxicity that I perceive, not toxicities that the patient has that are important. We see a lot of patient-reported outcomes now really helping drive it. If I think a patient, I remember when my father was being treated for gastric cancer. I was paying attention to him. He didn't seem to be having any side effects at all. But he wasn't going for walks down at the University Mall. He wasn't playing with the grandkids as much. Ask him what was up. He said, well, I'm worried that I might be out walking and get chemotherapy-induced diarrhea, not make it to the John, and just be a mess. The idea of toxicity was decreasing his quality of life. And so as we're going forward, having more of a focus on the patient and what their goals are is really a key if we're going to try to achieve these precision medicine goals beyond just having fancy technology. And so there's a whole lot of people that have to be involved in this sort of work. And I thank them. And I'll stop at that point and take questions as part of the panel. Thank you very much.